Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. My name is Michael Yolnoski. I'm the dean here, and on behalf of the law school and the university, I want to welcome all of you. I want to recognize, before we get started, and I'll be brief, but I want to recognize Lynn Friedman, who is a member of our Board of Trustees, Law School Board of Directors, as well, and a member of our adjunct faculty. Lynn was on the group that planned this particular event, but I want to, she's not in here, of course, but I want to give a little shout out to Chelsea Horn, who organized getting the exhibit from the ABA present here at the law school, and David DiMarzio is responsible for, we'll be taking the exhibit into his custody soon, so thank you, that's all worked so smoothly. This is a program that we're sponsoring in collaboration with the Federal District Court, and that collaboration has been smooth, as always. So what I'd like to do now is welcome the Chief Judge of that court, the Chairman of the Law School Board, also an adjunct faculty member, William Smith, who will say a few words and introduce our first two speakers. Good. It's really an honor to collaborate with Roger Williams University Law School on bringing this exhibit from the ABA to Rhode Island, and to have it in two locations here at the law school and at the district court, I think is terrific. But to have a program like this is even more special, because we really get to dig a little deeper with the program that the law school has put together today. So I want to thank Dean, Dave Logan, for thinking of and suggesting that the exhibit should be brought here. Programs like this, I think, are really valuable to us because they give us a chance to kind of step aside from the kind of the hurly-burly of our daily work as judges and lawyers and academics, and really focus on fundamental questions of why we do what we do and what drew us to the profession, and really what it would be like if it weren't for lawyers. And it's not very often that we take the time to do that, but I think it's really important that we do that as lawyers and judges and academics, so the keepers of this profession. So that's why I'm so excited that this exhibit is here and we're going to have a terrific program today. My job is very easy, and that is to introduce you to two people who need no introduction at all. One is Dean David Logan, just retired former dean, now professor of law at the law school. Confident everybody in this room knows David Logan, so I'm not going to say anything more about him. And the other is to introduce our first speaker, Judge Michael Silverstein. Judge Silverstein is on the Superior Court bench, where he has served with great distinction 21 years, and was in private practice for 35 years before that. So you can do the math. And I would venture to say he's probably the only one who was just barely alive at the time of the events that we're going to be discussing today. Judge Silverstein is a wonderful judge and a wonderful person. Who I've had the privilege of practicing before, attorney, serving as a judge. So I'm going to ask Judge Silverstein to get us started.
I am an American. I am Jewish. Just heard that for 35 years I practiced law, and for 21 years I've been a judge. Why do I tell you this? One of the brochures that announced this event had the following statement. The exhibit's Rhode Island sponsors hope that it sparks both personal reflection and public dialogue about the lessons of history and how they shed light on our current institutions and values. You're going to hear my perspective, not speaking for the judiciary, not speaking from a political point of view, hopefully, but my perspective, and I told you a little bit about me, because I think we're all a product of our environment. My thinking probably reflects my background. I was born in Providence. My family was born in Providence. My parents were born, essentially, in Providence. But going back beyond that, they came from Europe. And they were European Jews, not Germans, probably Russians. I know a little bit about the Holocaust. The events that are reflected in the exhibits really were the preamble, I suppose, to the Holocaust. They show that an effort, a conscious effort, was undertaken by those in power to decimate a portion of the legal profession and the judiciary. By the way, essentially the same thing probably happened in education. I said I know a little bit about the Holocaust. I think of the Holocaust in terms 6 million people, Jews, gypsies, socialists, whatever. I can't put a face on it in the abstract. That exhibit puts a face on it. That exhibit shows, in connection with some, I don't remember the number, 18 to 20, whatever, distinguished lawyers, distinguished judges, advocates, notaries, beginning of a turn that wasn't reacted to by the non-Jewish judges and lawyers or the populace. From that, you all know what happened. I'm sure you're going to hear more about it from our featured speaker. Why was there not an outcry? It's inexplicable to me. Fast forward to today. I read this little blurb from the brochure. It asked that I reflect on current institutions and values. I said before, these remarks are not political. But I am concerned, and I think we all ought to be concerned, when we turn on the television and see attacks as part of our political campaigns on groups of individuals, groups of people, campaign is early. But I don't hear any great outcry about the nature of some of the things that we all are hearing on television. I actually heard that there is a proposal supported by legal authority, I am told, to say that necessarily people who are born in the United States may not be citizens, despite what the Constitution says. I haven't heard great outcry about that. Maybe I'm missing something. I don't profess to be a constitutional expert. I would hope that after you view, if you haven't, the exhibits, you all have the same experience that I had, which is to make me stop and reflect and think about some of the things that I've mentioned. I'm only here for 10 minutes, and I've exhausted that now, but so be it. I do want to add one additional comment, and that is to both deans, to Lynn, to those on the faculty of the law school here. I take great pride in the fact that many years ago I had a limited role in the establishment of this law school. I served on two committees, one that was that consisted of the managing partners of some of the larger firms and some judges that did a review to determine whether or not there should be a law school and recommended the Board of Trustees, which I was on at that point, and was appointed to a committee of trustees to do a follow-up investigation. And from all that, incidentally, that was chaired by one of the great deceased now former chief justices of our state, from that came this, and for that, as I said, I have a little bit of pride.
Let's begin by thanking Judge Smith and Dave DiMarzio from the federal court, and Dean Lonosky and his staff here. This is a perfect example of why Rhode Island needed a law school. And it's also a perfect example of how deeply embedded we are in the judiciary and the practice of law in Rhode Island, and it couldn't happen. It's a two-way street. So I want to thank the judges and lawyers here for their part. I'm going to give a little bit of background, and then I'm going to add some more particular personal comments. But as an academic, I have to sort of give you the background, right? So here we go. In the late 17th century, won't spend a long time back there, substantial numbers of Jews began settling in the area we now call Slovakia. And like Jews across much of Europe, including Central Europe, they gradually gained rights. And many of them became active participants in their political, educational, and cultural lives of their countries. After World War I, the victors had on their hands the possibility, the option of creating new countries. And so they created Iraq, they created Yugoslavia, and they created Czechoslovakia, where there hadn't been countries before. And Czechoslovakia, as was the name suggests, was the Czechs, largely Protestants from the West, and the Slovaks, largely Catholics from the East. And so for a brief time, Czechoslovakia was a shining example of a successful democracy. And there were, at its peak, 135,000 Jews in Czechoslovakia, about 5% of the population. Jews were allowed to worship freely. Unlike in many countries, there were not quotas banning them from higher education, which was the case in the United States for many years. Then they were able to fully participate in the political, cultural, and professional life of their country. Now, you're going to hear from one of the country's great experts momentarily about the Holocaust, but I want to make a couple points about how the experience of Slovaks and my father fit into this. Basically, Hitler and his cronies came up with a three-step plan to deal with what they called the Jewish problem. The first one was to expropriate, to take away from Jews their ability to make a living. So one part meant Aryanizing businesses and then often turning them over to Gentile owners. There also was a plan to take Jews in government positions and universities and the professions and no longer allow them to engage in that kind of activity, that kind of meaningful professional and economic activity. Second step was to separate, to take the Jews and move them into ghettos, often in cities, and then at various points to move them into concentration camps. And a concentration camp just means concentrate. It doesn't necessarily mean what you do with them there, but to get the Jews out of the mainstream as best they could. And third was the physical removal of Jews from those ghettos and concentration camps through deportation, and after the Wannsee Conference in 1942, exterminate them. So those are the three steps. So Germany began this process in 1933, and in 1935 passed what you'll hear, I'm sure, about the Nuremberg Laws. And a key part of the Nuremberg Laws was to do two things. One was to define who was a Jew, because if you're going to discriminate against Jews, you've got to define who they are. And secondly, it was identifying those places in public life where Jews could not no longer perform. So it was the professions, it was universities and government positions. In March 1939, Hitler broke Czechoslovakia back into two, took the Czech part and made it part of the Reich, and created a nominally independent country called Slovakia and the Eastern Lands. As I suggested, the Eastern Lands were more Catholic, and he appointed, there was some vague effort at making this an election, but basically a very a Catholic priest who was very nationalistic and had anti-Semitic sympathies, but who was mostly a nationalist. But his prime minister was a hardline fascist who was deeply anti-Semitic. And so over the next couple of years, there was this battle between two leaders, both of whom didn't like Jews, one of which wanted to follow a gradual program of removal of Jews. Another one wanted to accelerate things and move Jews from public life and private life immediately and ship them out. And basically, Hitler chose to align himself with the hardline prime minister. And so very quickly, they started introducing various anti-Semitic laws, including laws that restricted the ability of Jews to be lawyers. And so Slovak Jews, you know, there may have been some lack of knowledge and sophistication of what was going on in Germany, but there was at least a general understanding of what was happening to Jews in Germany as a result of the Nuremberg Laws. And so Slovak Jews started to think, you know, I wonder how much of this is going to come our way. You know, and it seems to be moving very quickly. In Germany, it took 4, 5, 6 years for Hitler to sort of do this whole, most of this plan. In Slovakia, it looked like it was coming down to happen in 1 or 2 years. So basically, 1 year, all the Jewish businesses were Aryanized, and all Jews were told they could no longer work as lawyers, doctors, universities, and government officials. And Jews were fired from their jobs in large numbers, and the first step was completed, which was to turn Jews into the wards of the state, have no economic wherewithal. So that's the background. So here's my particular connection to it. My father was born Ladislav Lervenbaum in a small town called Trenčín, Czechoslovakia. Small town, 50,000 or so. And like, as I said before, many other places in Central Europe, he was raised in sort of a relatively normal life. He could go to college without there being quotas. Was able to go to law school and then went on and studied in Paris after to complete his legal studies. His father was a postal clerk, his mother was a homemaker. They were not observant, but they were Jews by virtually any definition that the government chose to use, and certainly the one that was used by the Slovaks. So he completed his studies, he came back to his hometown and hung his shingle, went into a general practice, and spent 3 or 4 years representing whatever sort of came through the door. Then in 1939, the Reign of Terror began, and there was untrammeled street violence against Jews, much like there had been by the stormtroopers in Germany, but also the implementation of these Czech versions of these Nuremberg Laws, which said to people, including my father and his brother, a doctor, they could no longer practice their professions. And so they decided to escape before the borders closed behind them, as they had in some other countries. And so my father shuttered his law practice, and his brother diagnosed him as having a nervous breakdown and said they had to go to Yugoslavia to the Dalmatian coast for rest and relaxation. And somehow the authorities bought it. Now, you couldn't leave with any money, and you could leave with the clothes on your back, but at least you could leave. So my father and his brother left in 1939 in late July, early August. And I'm sure they expected at some point, as most people did, that this would pass and that families would be reunited. But the parents were in their 60s, and they had no interest in packing up and going on the road, whereas young people were both psychologically and physically more willing to take those risks. But there was not to be any reunion. Like Schindler's List, stormtroopers arrived one night in this town of Trenchen, forcibly removed all the Jews in town, and fortunately, at that point, at that town, they weren't sent to death camps. Rather, the Slovaks had set up substantial labor camps, places where you would work people to death, but you'd get some meaningful economic value out of them rather than sending them off to be gassed in gas chambers. So his parents, my grandparents, were sent to these work camps in a rural part of Czechoslovakia. Their home was taken, and my father's office was turned into a barbershop, given to a classmate of his from elementary school. The brothers went to Yugoslavia, then Italy, which he said treated Jews much better than Slovaks did, even though they were formally aligned with Hitler. And then finally to the south of France. And like tens of thousands, and I suspect there may be some of your comments on it, but tens of thousands of Jews, but also a substantial number of communists, homosexuals, political pariahs, were pressed down on the border of South France, desperately trying to get across Spain, which was fascist, to Portugal. And if any of you are fans of the movie Casablanca, that's about getting the papers to get to Lisbon. Remember the letter, in the very beginning, Sam hides the papers under the piano, and at the very end, Rick is there, and he's getting ready, his love of his life is deciding to fly with her Czech patriot to London to freedom. So the goal was to get to Lisbon. Lisbon was an open city. And it's a whole interesting story about how Salazar played both sides against the middle. But the goal was for many, 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 many people to get to Lisbon. So it took my father and his brother 2 years to get to Lisbon. And once you get to Lisbon, if you had connections and money, but just good luck, you could get to London, you could get to the United States, or to Palestine. And the ship that my parents, my father and his brother got on happened to be going to the United States. So it took 2 years to get to New York, to Ellis Island. And in a story that we still don't know the exact explanation for, he became Leslie Logan, and his brother became Joseph Logan. And like many immigrants, had their names that the families had given them, and they had lived with as professionals, as individuals, for, in my father's case, 33 years, a brand new name that sounded American. So I'm David Logan, the son of Ladislav Lervenbein. My father spoke no English, he spoke six languages, and like many Central Europeans, you have to be multilingual, which you never knew was going to be ruling you at any given time. But he had no money, he couldn't speak English, so he couldn't go to law school. So he took a bunch of menial jobs, busboy in a restaurant, night watchman, gradually found a job as a radio announcer for the Voice of America, because it turned out the Cold War, we wanted to beam our propaganda to Slovaks with Slovak voices. So my father found a life as a radio broadcaster, not a lawyer, but he found a meaningful life and meaningful work in the United States. Of course, he never saw his parents again, but he was very proud of the life he built in this country, and in particular the fact that both of his sons became lawyers, but also became law professors. He had a great respect for both the legal profession and for the academy. So one final anecdote. In 1996, I had never gone back. My father never went back. My brother, my uncle never went back. But in 1996, we decided to do what we call our roots tour. And so my son Ben and my son Daniel, my wife Jeannie and I, and my brother gathered in Bratislava, rented a van with a driver and a Slovak speaker, because in a lot of Slovakia in 1996, English wasn't understood. And so we decided to go look for the town and the graves and the sort of the history of my family, which we had never been able to see firsthand. But we did have one interesting clue. We had tracked down a middle-aged man. Track this for a minute, it's a little bit complicated. Whose Gentile mother was my father's law secretary, legal secretary. Okay? And we met him with our translators in a small restaurant in Trenton. And he brought with him a manila folder. And through the translator, he explained to us that he was giving me a copy of a letter that was on my father's letterhead. I'd never seen his letterhead. When you're a refugee, you don't carry your letterhead with you when you hit the road. So I had no evidence of him practicing law of that sort. It was a reference letter my father had written, likely dictated to her, and she typed in Slovak, that said, more or less, because of law, I can no longer practice law. Because these new laws, these anti-Jewish laws, I can no longer practice law. But I recommend Eva Skarbova. She's a very diligent and loyal secretary. I don't speak Slovak. Maybe he said she took a good shorthand. I don't know. But this was now, this is the most cherished piece of evidence I have of my father's life as a lawyer. And it's a poignant reminder of that my father had a real life, an honest, respectable member of the community before he came to this country. And it's also a reminder, and this is something that I think both the judges that preceded me will agree, that that little piece of paper is a tangible example of why the rule of law matters and why the people that enforce the rule of law, which are the lawyers and the judges, are so incredibly important to live in a democracy that respects us and to be part of the educational process that turns in the next generation of lawyers. So for that reason, I'm delighted this exhibit is here, and I'm delighted to participate, and thank you very much.
So my name is Bruce Cogan. I'm on the faculty here at Roger Williams. I, like the dean, was one of the founding faculty members 22 years ago when the doors opened to a then under construction building, which we have it is my sincere pleasure to introduce Professor Richard Weisberg, who is the Florsheimer Professor of Constitutional Law at Cardozo Law School, which is part of Yeshiva University in New York. Richard has his bachelor's degree from Brandeis, his master's and PhD from Cornell, and his JD from Columbia. Richard is no stranger to Roger Williams Law School because he previously visited here to teach an honors perspectives course, to participate in a symposium that Carl organized on lawyer collaboration with systems of evil, was a part of our community for a semester, and it was wonderful to have Richard here. Then Richard's participation in this program makes complete sense. Richard has spent a significant portion of his scholarly activity, and Richard is a prolific scholar, has written books, many articles, but a lot of his scholarship has focused on the law in connection with what happened in Europe during the Holocaust. And he has a very respected book on this. And the work that he's done both in the academy and outside the academy, because Richard has been successfully involved in litigation involving reparations, restitution to Holocaust survivors, particularly with regard to what French banks did to Jewish families, the wealth of Jewish families during World War II. Richard's been involved in that over a long time. Was appointed by Professor Obama to the U.S. Commission on the Preservation of America's Heritage Abroad. And in 2009, had bestowed upon him the French Legion of Honor for his human rights work helping to institute recognition of the Jewish victims of the Vichy regime. I said Richard is no stranger to the law school. Richard is also no stranger to me. Our mothers pushed us to Central Park in baby carriages in 1944. So I've known Richard my whole life. Richard is my closest friend. And his career path to law and to the legal academy, you know, we have sort of managed to keep on the same path and have managed to stay in touch with each other. So having Richard come here is a personal pleasure for me, you know, to spend some time with him, and today with another classmate of ours from elementary school and junior high school and high school, Pam Foa, who's at Brown University. So it's a personal pleasure. Richard and I not only went to school together, but we were teammates on a very famous New York institution, the Panthers, which was a club that Richard founded, where we challenged other teams of kids to play ball with each other. And so that's part of my memory of Richard. And so, you know, there's a lot of nostalgia there. And now I look at this resume and have Richard here and realize he's actually accomplished another aspiration of ours from when we were children, which is, at one point, we thought we might run away and join the French Foreign Legion. And in fact, he's done that, and I never got to do that. So it's my pleasure to introduce my friend, my oldest friend, Richard Weisberg.
Well, what can you say after that kind of from this kind of close and wonderful friend? I'll just add that Bruce's remarks were so effusively kind that it calls to mind the response of many speakers who get wonderful introductions, and they say, well, that is the kind of introduction that my mother would have totally agreed with, and my wife would have completely disagreed with. So, on the other hand, my wife was with me in that wonderful earlier visit that we were able to have to this terrific law school, and she regrets not being able to come here today for this sensational event, and I would obviously like to thank all of the organizers and also the earlier speakers today who really touched me each in his own way very much, but of course thank Dean Yalmowski just for inviting me, Dean Morgan for his remarks just now, Judge Smith and Judge Silverstein. It is a sensational exhibit. And even if you've been working in the field for a certain amount of time, you learn a lot, an extraordinary amount. And it's encouraged me to maybe alter some of the things, or even the structure of what I was going to speak to you about today, except in the following way. I want to bring in France actively, somewhat in comparison with what we learned through the exhibit about Germany. In France during World War II, 1940 to 1944, in the case of what we call Vichy France, the regime that the Germans more or less permitted to exist autonomously in the southern part of France. Most of you know that story. It has a little bit to do with Casablanca because Vichy law, which had a strongly anti-Semitic component to it and was promulgated autonomously by the French in the zone called Vichy that the Germans permitted them to have under Marshal Pétain. Vichy law also extended to North Africa. And much of what goes on in that wonderful film has this coloration of Vichy, which is mentioned, Claude Rains is a Vichy policeman. The story of France during World War II is a sad and shameful story. It took a while for that story to come out. I'm going to tell you a little bit about it, but by now most people do know about it. The German story, of which we see so many tragic evocations connected to lawyers in the exhibit, was a story that for many reasons had to emerge fairly quickly after the war. I might add the German reparations, since Bruce was kind enough to mention some work I did involving reparations for victims of Vichy, property restitution that took place through the federal courts in the United States and eventually a French administrative agency. The story about France was kind of covered over for about 40 or 50 years. It was a massive PR job done by people who I otherwise admire, especially responsible for not getting the shameful part of the story of France during World War One, during World War II out, was Charles de Gaulle himself, who kind of single-handedly and single-mindedly revived France from the ashes which he knew France had fallen into because of its behavior during World War II. And he single-mindedly and single-handedly promoted various myths. And I think each country in Hitler's Europe had its own myth, ways of trying to avoid people recognizing that it wasn't just Hitler and the Third Reich, but it was a series of other regimes, some of them relatively autonomous, as in France, others Quislings and collaborationists. It was a series of regimes, country by country, that in their own way did the evil work, a word we unabashedly were willing to use in the symposium that Bruce mentioned, Carl Bogus organized a couple of years ago, collaborations with systems of evil. That evil work was done in different ways, country by country. So I want to let you know a little bit about what France did, and to be on line with what we're talking about in this exhibit, specifically what they did to lawyers. The story is not dissimilar to what you have learned out there and maybe from other reading that you've done. The story is not dissimilar from the one that we see in this exhibition, but there are some very interesting nuances and differences. I want to read in the spirit of the very, very personal and touching stories that we have heard today, both in the exhibit and also more personally from the speaker who just told us an amazing story about his own father. I want to talk to you personally about Jewish lawyers during Vichy France who were persecuted and the response of their colleagues at the bar, because we were asked to think about why there was no outcry. These things went on country by country, and in general, with several exceptions, very rare, our profession did not speak up against the obvious persecution, isolation, expropriation, and eventually extermination that was occurring and being forced upon their own Jewish legal colleagues. Why was there no outcry? This is a huge question, and it's relevant in the year 2015. I don't know if I'm going to be able to answer that today, but I will tell you that when Jewish lawyers in Paris, that is in the occupied zone, where German troops were present and a German administrative government was ruling, French lawyers were very quickly isolated, some of them arrested, and found themselves at the risk of losing their lives. Some of the most prominent lawyers at the French bar, whose stories would be even better known in France at the time than maybe the stories of some of the lawyers here, whose careers were short-circuited so badly, these were lawyers who were well known at the bar. And they found themselves very quickly into the Vichy regime. In the occupied and unoccupied zones, they found themselves at great risk. Jacques Charpentier was the head of the Paris Bar Association, a very powerful man, a very powerful official. After the war, he wrote about some of these colleagues. He wrote a book called Au Service de la Liberté that was published in 1946. For a while, it was about the only thing we could find out about the treatment of Jewish lawyers until the archives opened really in the mid to late 70s and early 80s in France. And I was fortunate to be one of the first researchers to get into the Paris Bar Association and to see some of their files. There was great resistance in France on all public levels until about the early to mid 1980s, and there still is some. In opening the book about what the French actually did. But Charpentier wrote in 1946 his own personal feelings when he saw that distinguished colleagues at the French bar were being disbarred, arrested in some cases, forced eventually to wear the Jewish star on their robes when arguing in court, if they still had the possibility of arguing in court. Their property expropriated and blocked, and in other ways being victimized by a regime that was both German in the occupied zone, but very much influenced by French legalistic anti-Semitism coming from Vichy. And he says about these colleagues, what was their crime? That of having professed a political belief to which they ardently adhered. That statement alludes to the fact that some of the lawyers who were arrested first had left-wing socialist tendencies. And they were talking only, though, right now about Jewish members of the bar. What was their crime? Or that even more grave of remaining faithful to their professional mission of defending their comrades? Like some of the lawyers in Germany, right up through the early 1940s, if they were able to, they used their skills and talents to help defend even less fortunate people. What was their crime? He finishes a short statement by labeling their crime as follows. Above all, they were lawyers. Their speech was free, and they pleaded undisguisedly. They stepped to the bar, especially in the criminal courtrooms, where those they defended were unpopular. They spoke with fervor. They denounced intolerance. And they exclaimed their passion for justice. Taken as hostages, as was true of half dozen of the most famous lawyers at the bar, just before being shot at the fortress of Ivry during a feeble dawn of day, they addressed to their professional leader, meaning himself, the head of the Bar Association, moving farewells that resonate still for us as we read them, with appeals to the freedom of defending others that these executioners could never stifle. Beautiful words, post-war words, from the head of the Bar Association. Too many of his colleagues were being arrested, some of them murdered, and a few of them showed up on the first deportation trains to leave France for the East in early 1942. People like Pierre Masse and other people, well-known names still to this day within France. But here's what's interesting and ambiguous about Jacques Charpentier's eulogies, really, post-war. There was no public outcry from the French Bar Association. The French Bar Association, unlike the way law developed in Germany during this tragic period, the French Bar Association retained a sense of its own autonomy, prideful autonomy from Marshal Pétain's regime. For example, I don't know if you've been to the Palais de Justice, which is where a lot of the action of the I'm now talking to you about took place. That's the Paris Bar and pleading that takes place within that wonderful courtroom in Paris and that palatial structure. The regime wished to impose an oath to Marshal Pétain. Civil servants had to take that oath. Judges and all Jewish judges, which was also true in Germany, all Jewish judges, and prosecutors and assistants and were summarily dismissed early in both regimes, 1933 in Germany, 1940 in France. Lawyers continued to practice, gradually reducing the number of Jewish lawyers through a numerous clauses. The Bar Association in Paris refused to have its members take an oath to Marshal Pétain, claiming that our organization is a group of liberal professionals. We are not attached to the regime the way you might say judges are, in a way, or civil servants. We're part of a great liberal profession. And we don't take an oath to any leader. And remember, these are terrible autocratic times in which even that kind of stance was very risky. And they prevailed. They never had to take an oath specifically to the leader of the Vichy regime. But they never mustered their forces, although able to protest vigorously and effectively, as lawyers can do and as bar associations can do, they never mustered their forces under Charpentier's leadership to challenge the racial laws that their own regime was promulgating against the Jews and to challenge the treatment that their own members were receiving. Any consolation, solace, any feelings of regret were expressed exclusively privately. Here's what Charpentier said publicly, even after the war, about why he could not or chose not to get his very powerful membership capable of protest in many ways against autocratic regimes, standing up in some ways even to the Nazi occupiers, could not get them to protest publicly and work against the laws that were identifying their colleagues and others as Jews, which were laws their own regime promulgated that were more extensive and expansive, more punitive than even the Nazi laws, even the Nuremberg laws of 1935. Since 1940, says Charpentier in the same book, a law excluded the sons of refugees from the profession of law. For several prior years, this type of measure was strongly desired by the Paris Bar. Now, he's not talking about Jews exclusively. He's talking about lawyers who didn't have French parents. Before the war, he continues, we were invaded by those recently naturalized, and this kind of rings a bell, doesn't it? We were invaded by those recently naturalized, almost all of Eastern origin, whose language was ridiculed by the press, thus covering us with shame. We're talking about the old line lawyers at the bar in Paris. They were subject to ridicule because these other lawyers who were quite competent and were pleading had foreign accents and foreign ways about them. They brought to the conduct of their practice the customs of their bazaars. Now, this is one of the most outspoken, as I've pointed out to you, and I've read only one passage of the many very sympathetic, eulogizing passages expressing deep sadness about the persecution of Jewish lawyers in France, which was not dissimilar, maybe took a longer time, and was, I think, more subtle and complex than the persecution of the German lawyers who were Jewish that we see in this exhibit. And yet, he's really giving us an answer to the question, why was there no protest? Everybody felt uncomfortable, not about the old line French lawyers, they regretted that those people were suffering, but about those who had come from the East, fleeing Hitler in many cases, but not exclusively, and who brought to the bar the customs of their bazaars. It's pretty damning and supplies a one-word answer at least, and there have to be other answers as well, to the question, why was there no protest? And here, from the very group that was protesting in so many other ways and areas, the autonomy of the bar as they always understood it from even the most autocratic regimes. It's called xenophobia. In thinking about why, the why question, which everybody who works in this area is always thinking about, how could such a thing happen? Why did it happen? And now again, my focus is based on this exhibition. There are many, many questions that can be categorized under that big umbrella question, why? Why did no one speak up? In France, a key answer, I think, is xenophobia. And I think it's a very important question for us today, as one of the earlier speakers pointed out. The sickness of xenophobia led to, I'm not overstating this, led to participation by some of the best and the brightest and the most liberally minded professional communities in Europe in genocide, in isolation, identification, expropriation, imprisonment, and genocide. Those are Raoul Hilberg's five steps towards every genocide, some of which are going on in the world today. Every genocide, Hilberg says, talking about the one in Europe that we are considering, every genocide has those steps. The first step is identification. Who is a Jew? That's very complicated. We have gone through this in the United States, identifying racial minorities as a matter of law. We have gone through this, and God forbid we may be going through this again. Identification, complicated process involving lawyers and judges and a lot of hair splitting and complicated analysis involving grandparental heritage, which was a factor in Jewish identification both in France and in Germany. In France, if you had more than two Jewish grandparents, you were irrebuttably considered a Jew. And if you only had one Jewish grandparent under Vichy law, you were irrebuttably considered a non-Jew, even if you were, in fact, Jewish, secretly Jewish, ritualistically Jewish, unless you announced, I'm Jewish. The complicated case were the Mischlinge, as the Germans would call them, that is, descendants of two Jewish and two non-Jewish grandparents, which occupied French courts and French law professors and treatise writers and lawyers in their practice over a four-year period. And it was pretty good business in trying to make these distinctions in all of those categories. Identification, isolation, we see that in all of the stories having to do with German lawyers. A terrible sense of just losing all your bearings. You are ripped out because of this identification from all of the anchors that kept you alive and active. And the bar did very little. Throughout France, I've studied not only the Paris Bar, but other bar associations, such as in Lyon, very little to re-anchor or re-inspire and invigorate its Jewish colleagues. Identification, isolation, like other Jews in every country in Hitler's Europe, expropriation. We are only now beginning to make amends in to some extent with the help of American federal courts, although the process is very slow and fraught with risk, to bring a measure of justice back for those in France and other countries in Hitler's Europe who were ripped off, and we're talking about billions of dollars. In France, we managed to restore 150 million euros. It's a drop in the bucket of property that was expropriated and has not yet been returned. It's a huge ongoing story. Of course, it involves art restitution, and we all know some of the more famous stories there. Imprisonment, as these lawyers were imprisoned quickly, some of them, and eventually, genocide means extermination, vernichtung, and the French lost 75,000 Jews, largely deported under color of French law itself. Of French law itself, from both the occupied and unoccupied zone. How did it happen? Well, xenophobia is just a small slice of the pie, but it's an important answer coming from France. France and Germany, I think, did have in common, and I'll close on this because obviously we all want to leave room for your questions, so there's so much more that can be said. There was a racial component in both countries, far more virulent in Germany. French racism was of more of a polite variety, and you've even heard a little bit of that in what I've read to you, than the jugular frontal racism that came out of Germany, obviously, from the get-go. Fear of the left, fear that somehow liberal professions will drift towards causes like socialism and communism. Fear of liberal individualism in and of itself, which we associate with the practice of law at its best. Autonomy from authorities that impose their sense of things on us. Lawyers are supposed to be, and often are, in the vanguard of those who are thinking critically about accepted truths. Well, the leaders in France and Germany feared that greatly. For that reason, by the way, Hitler hated all lawyers. Think about some lawyer jokes. Some of them originated with Adolf Hitler. He really absolutely detested all lawyers. Jews just were an especially detested subcategory of that. So it's overdetermined why these terrible things happen. It's overdetermined, and we have to continue to try to think about it. In Germany, unlike in France, there was from the beginning a drive to have everybody belong to the community, to the folk, as opposed to sustaining individual rights. That was less true, as I've told you, in France. The idea of the Führerprinzip, that judges should make decisions not according to statute books, but according to what the community, the folk, as led by Hitler, apparently would want in each case. German distortions of law were not based on positivism, but a distorted, sickened form of communal natural law in which the Führer's will, even if there were no statutes on the books, was supposed to dictate outcomes in court. You didn't get that in France. You didn't have that sense of community. And those lawyers who did manage to survive, and some of them were Jews, either because the Jews in Paris and elsewhere in France hid their identity. I interviewed two people who just said, I have four Jewish grandparents. I just never announced myself as Jewish, and I pleaded at the bar in Paris unimpeded for 4 years. That was very unusual for different reasons. The bar, to the extent that the quotas permitted Jews, or those with records in World War I of bravery, or in the Drôle de Guerre, which had just occurred, of bravery, who managed to get exceptions, and there was some of that in Germany too, believe it or not. Those who managed to survive until later years in France did try, with the exception of this Jewish question, to maintain the great principles of individual liberal legal professionalism. So there are differences, but tragically, the main story is one of similarly sad, sometimes incomprehensible tale that we have to continue to consider. Thank you very much.
So we deliberately did try to set aside some time for questions and answers. If anybody would like to ask a question, I would just appreciate it if you would identify yourself. Don't need to be at the mic. Just identify yourself. I'm delighted to see that there are some folks here who haven't been here before. A special welcome to you, although the person who's about to ask a question has been here and is a student, and also welcome to our students. So please.
My name is Matthew Thomas. I'm a 2L here. I want to thank everyone. It was really fantastic. Seeing the exhibit and hearing the story today made me think about my own grandfather and the anti-Semitism he faced working in the federal government during World War II. And then I was wondering the response from the American bar to what was going on in Europe. If you guys know much about that, obviously we know the general apathy to what was going on, but specifically along the South.
Not a happy story. The one very well-known example involves a great Czech figure named Charsky. No, he's Polish, but let's call him a Czech. almost as tall as you are, and an elegant figure who actually was led through the concentration camps and came out of them wanting to tell the story to Americans. What's going on? Not too many people have witnessed this. And he targeted, he was a very, very elegant, modest person. He wasn't, you know. But people said, why don't you speak to Justice Frankfurter, who was sitting on the court? And as happened often in other, with other witnesses who were trying to tell people what was happening, Frankfurter essentially said to Charsky, you know, I've heard what you say, but I just can't believe the stories that you're telling. So that's really the, one of the highest Jewish figures, at any rate, obviously, who were in positions of authority during the war. A person otherwise very sensitive to his own Jewish roots. And we know a lot now about what actually happened, and it still does seem incredible.
Let me just add a couple quick things. There were many people in the federal government, particularly the State Department, that were anti-Semitic, and the Secretary of State was a deeply anti-Semitic man. So among the things that were going on were tightening the vise on immigration. And I don't know for sure whether there were German lawyers, Jewish lawyers in the Department of State and other parts of the federal government that were turning a blind eye to what was going on there, but it would surprise me if there were no Jewish lawyers in this. And as Professor Weisberg said, much of this was a conspiracy of cowardice as opposed to a conspiracy of active support for bad behavior. And the why question, why American lawyers didn't see the threat to French lawyers and Czech lawyers who they knew were not able to practice law anymore, you know, got a notion. And we didn't feel as immediately threatened as Britain did. The question would be, the British bar would be a little closer question, right? Because they were physically and essentially adjacent to France, what was happening in France. And I don't remember any stories about the British bar stepping up.
If I can put in a plug, the only thing my dear friend did not mention about my whole past that you would want to mention publicly is that I do have a new book called In Praise of Intransigence, and In Praise of Intransigence does tell the story in a way of the British bar as translated into the British Channel Islands. I don't know if any of you know this. The British Channel Islands were occupied for 5 years. Jersey, Guernsey, Alderney, Sark, I don't even know if anybody's been there, were occupied for 5 years. English-speaking peoples who had British traditions of fair play and due process. Also, not a happy story. Deportations took place from the islands. They developed their own racial laws. Very little protest, though there was one intransigent, and in my mind, that's good in this sense, a man who stood up and said, what we are doing is wrong on the Channel Islands. But there's a lot more that we really have to learn, you know, about what exactly happened as far as the United States.
Yes, Jasmine.
Well, as was stated earlier, and I suppose it's true for many, the Holocaust doesn't have a fate. For me, it did. My grandfather was arrested in 1940 in April as part of the AB movement because he was a teacher, not because he was Jewish. Because when Hitler invaded Germany and Poland, once they finished that, they decided that anyone intellectual was a threat. So they took them all away. Well, he managed to survive, which is the reason I'm alive, because my dad was born after the war. But he never stayed quiet about it. And even during the communist times, he still spoke up against the government, and as he did back then, too. So for me, it's always been something that's been there. It's always been a part of family history. It's always been something I've known. My grandfather taught me my favorite word when I was 3, and I think I ran around screaming it for days. So how do we keep that alive, though, for people who don't necessarily have that, and even for those who do? I mean, my grandfather died in 2007. He was born in 1910. those who did survive and are alive. They're not going to be around for long. So how do we keep it alive so it doesn't just fade away, something that just gets forgotten?
Because of people like you.
And perhaps through exhibits like this.
Right. But Younger, your question entails its own answer. And if you will be out there, you will make sure that you will not, you know. And there are a lot of other people like you.
And that will make you a better warrior, too.
That's the reason I'm here. I want to talk back to this.
Yes.
Just quickly, I'm the past president of the Holocaust Education System in the Jewish Alliance, and I find I have a plethora of great speakers. We teach the young people. We teach it. We're going to get in the curriculum, the public schools. Many do. The Catholic schools have been wonderful, and we teach Holocaust genocide, and it's very necessary, and this is just a great, great resource for us, and I'm sure if we could call on any of you to speak to our young children, there's no better way to educate them than somebody to teach them. Thank you.
Questions? Yes, David, and then
Mary. I was just going to make a comment, a concern that I experienced probably a good 15 years ago now. I have a good friend, a young woman who's an attorney in Germany, born and raised German, grandfather, who fought in World War II and on the Russian front. And she happened to come as an intern when I was in Boston, and we took her in and came very close to her. And I remember having an interesting Thanksgiving dinner with her, with my father at the table. My father had been in World War II, had been through the war from North Africa to Sicily, D-Day plus two. Unbeknownst to me until after he died, he liberated one of the camps, and I found photographs I never knew existed, and notes about the horror of the situation. But to be at a table where we were talking about things, and the sense of denial that this woman has, a lack of desire to want to talk about that, concerned me, because you think nowadays that Germany is a different place. You know, it's maybe a bit more enlightened. You'd like to think that things have changed. But what concerns me there, and I wonder if the same is true in Japan from World War II as well, we don't realize that there's a denial and a constant attempt to gloss over and push away as though, you know, we had no responsibility in this. This attitude that ultimately is setting us up again, once again, for the possibility somewhere down the road that this is going to happen, despite the fact that we have people who can speak to it either indirectly because their parents suffered through it, or indirectly because my father saw the horror that was caused. How do we not only keep it alive here, but how do we continue to engage in areas where people want to just pretend it didn't happen to?
Well, since you referenced Germany, and since education is such an important part of, sustaining people's sensitivities long after the last survivor has died about this issue, I just want to mention that I've taught German law students about the Holocaust. I co-taught a course with Bernard Schlink. Maybe some of you know, he's a wonderful writer. He's a judge in Germany, and he's a law professor, but he's a novelist. He wrote a novel called The Reader, Der Vorleser, The Reader, which was made into a huge Hollywood thing. He's a friend of mine, but, you know, sometimes you can envy your friends. Oprah mentioned his book. But I'm raising this because I met... 25 students took the class. It wasn't only about the Holocaust. It was about some of the readings touched on the Holocaust. And I'm a little more hopeful, at least at the moment, from hearing them and talking to them, that the memory will be sustained very sensitively. A few of them were still shattered emotionally, and they didn't do anything. Their parents really didn't do anything, and in some cases, their grandparents were not culpable. And yet, one of them said to me, she was from Nuremberg, that every day she goes back to her hometown, she feels a great sense of shame. Nuremberg was, you know, especially active anti-Semitic Hitler, with the Hitler, all of the parades and the laws that originated there. But you're right, we don't know any more than we know, you know, what our own younger generation will do. We, you know, we can just... Well, Germany, so far, I'm not all that concerned about, you know, but I think some other countries in Europe, there may be some sliding back.
Hungary.
Hungary's a real bad situation.
I think the word you use is shame. I think that was what I was sensing, is that there's a shame element there, and if we could break through the shame element and be able to talk and get beyond that, I don't know how you do that, but that's what my sense was holding us back in the conversation.
But I think in a younger person, it was very, very moving to see a person who had no reason whatsoever to feel regretful about her own generation. That sense of shame, I think, was being channeled into a lot of thinking in her heart, not only her brain, about never again, and how could this have happened?
Mary? Yeah, it seems that here, as I suspect in Germany, there was this sense that this can't happen here, that we have, you know, very robust advocacy on behalf of the disenfranchised, and we have clearly have a very well-functioning legal system as compared to many other countries. But I know that was the belief certainly among assimilated Jews in Germany as well. I mean, my grandparents thought it's not going to happen here until 1938. And I wonder what within both the judiciary and the legal profession, how prior to National Socialism, how robust was the defense of individual rights and the rights of minorities? Did that exist? Was it not part of that tradition?
There are several references in the exhibit about Weimar.
Mm-hmm.
Weimar was between the wars, somewhat idealistic regime that came out of World War I in Germany. Weimar is a very complicated story, and you can read terrific books that have been translated by people like Ingo Müller and Michael Stallas to learn more, and many other historians, they happen to be lawyers, about the Weimar period. Weimar tried to inculcate through its constitution and in other ways a different kind of attitude, less authoritarian, in Germany than you had even before World War I. It was an imperial regime, you know, which had authoritarian judges and others. In France, it was the Third Republic, and that means liberty, equality, and fraternity. And I won't say in the twinkling of an eye, because this doesn't happen that way, but relatively quickly, most French lawyers turned around and accepted the regime's new approach, which reversed most Third Republic or Republican values. It can happen. Transition is a part of our lives. Transition of regimes is a part of our lives. So things can happen relatively quickly. There needs to be a bulwark of individuals who will speak up in support of what they and others feel were the best of the values that they feel need to be sustained, and there wasn't very much of that.
Colleen? I was struck when I learned a little bit about the Dachau trials that the U.S. conducted of war criminals, that there were many convictions, but then very few punishments because the U.S. found it more expedient to get Germany on our side during the Cold War. So I wonder if that's part of the explanation, right? If it was expedient for the United States to say, okay, we're not going to go ahead and prosecute these people that have been convicted of war crimes because we want to win the Cold War. We want to get good situation in terms of power over Russia. Doesn't that explain it at an individual level as well? It's expedient not to pursue this.
Well, I think there were also trials led actually by the great Nuremberg prosecutor Telford Taylor, who's fortunately for me a colleague of mine for about 5 or 6 years, where judges were put on trial. And you're quite right that although there were convictions, those judges, and it's very complicated, those trials are very complicated and fascinating for us, and you can find the transcripts and explanations. Very few of them spent very much time in jail if they were convicted. Life goes on, and we have kind of flexible, pragmatic developments that are always challenging our own individual sense of something wrong maybe is going on here. You know, maybe we shouldn't be playing ball with the country that we just defeated to the extent that we are fighting communism by letting these war criminals go. I don't know if it's human nature or just the way societies operate, but I think the same thing happened during the war itself. That is to say, people just said, we have new conditions now. We have a new France that lives in a new Europe. In Germany, Hitler was a master at both creating and playing on people's fear of emergencies. And we have had our share of emergencies in this country during our own lifetimes. Sometimes they're created by our leaders. Sometimes they actually happen. But emergencies make us tend to feel that we need to move along to the next step. 9/11 is an example. You know, a lot of, I know it's the wrong, it's another conference. I'm sure you've all been following legal developments, or you should, post 9/11, both in the Bush and in Obama, a man I respect very much. In both of those administrations, there have been some remarkable deviations from what the rule of law seemed to mean prior to that. I think, to their credit, some lawyers have sort of tried to say, yeah, we have an emergency, but we don't think that everything has changed. We're not so sure about wiretapping. We're not so sure about Guantanamo. We're not so sure about drone strikes, et cetera. So there are iterations of this, I think, phenomenon that we need to be aware of. If you have an emergency, you know, it's human nature, so, and professional nature. An emergency changes everything. We've got to move on.
But isn't this all about demonization of the other? You know, the and fear of the other. So the other changes. You know, the other changes. So one time it was the Jews for the other, that was convenient. Now it's Muslim terrorists are the other, and so there's fear of the other.
Yeah.
You can justify an awful lot by demonization of the other.
And if there's an emergency, you double down.
I'm just a lawyer in Rhode Island. Glad to be here. I have a question.
Just an old country lawyer.
Just an old country
lawyer.
I have a question. But first, I want to just thank the people who organized this for keeping this story alive. This is wonderful. It's so good. My question is, I'm concerned about 2015 and this country, to be blunt. And I recently read, I don't know how to pronounce his last name, I think it's Tybee, Matt Tybee writes for the Rolling Stone, and he wrote an article about this vast crowd of people running for presidency. He analogized it to a clown car, which is a small car where like 15 or 20 clowns keep coming out of the car and you don't know how many more were in there. And it was very, very well written, very entertaining article. My concern, though, is there a danger, and I'm wondering if people's knowledge of what happened in Europe leading up to the Holocaust, is there a danger that we
think, and then maybe the Germans thought, that Hitler was just a nut. Until he really achieved power, was he viewed as just a nut and not to be taken seriously. And it couldn't happen here. And is that what we're potentially doing right now? Because there are a lot of nuts. But what I hear a lot of is, oh, he's just a nut. It could never happen here. And I'm wondering, did Germans think of Hitler up in, it's kind of hard to, based on what I saw in the lobby downstairs, it's hard to imagine that after 1933 or so, people wouldn't be really scared. But I'm wondering if initially there was an attitude of, he's just a nut, we're good people, we're bright people, we would not let that happen here. Is that a danger that we face today?
Paul, can I tackle that? I'm Paul Geyer, I'm a professor of philosophy at Brown. I think the answer is no. That is to say, in the early 20s, like at the time of the Munich Beer Hall Putsch, he was one right-wing fanatic among many, and the Nazi Party was tiny. But he was more successful. You know, eventually, of course, he was much more successful than others, but he wasn't more extreme than others. And then, of course, you have to remember, he was voted in 1933 with a huge majority after the Nazi Party had very tiny vote percentages up until 1930 or even later. But he wasn't. He wasn't a clown. He was representing what a lot of people wanted, eventually settled down on him. But he represented something that a lot of people wanted.
But I have never sat on a panel with other judges where there would be a dissent, but I would respectfully, based on the comments I made in my remarks, dissent.
I think we have time for one more, but I encourage you, we've got some refreshments out in the atrium where the exhibit is, to continue these conversations, but for now, Judge Vogel.
Thank you. I don't often admit anything about my age, but I was born shortly after the end of the war. And being Jewish and being raised...
The Vietnamese War?
Yeah. It was Korea. And my father was born in Czechoslovakia and had come here as a child, but other family members had not been so lucky, and they were killed by the Nazis. I lived in a Jewish neighborhood. My next-door neighbors had tattoos on them, so I was really raised... It's really part of my personal culture. But I had the benefit of being raised in a wonderful time where I wasn't discriminated against, where there was an effort to embrace the survivors. And it was politically incorrect to be anti-Semitic. I'm going to say that over the last year or two in my entire life, I have seen more anti-Semitism in reports that come out of Europe and some out of the United States and some in educational institutions, discriminatory. It's shocking. I never thought I would live to see that. And I'm just going to, I'm reminded of Martin Niemöller, right? Which I don't think I will say it very well, but... when the Nazis came, and I could be wrong about my history here, to take the communists, I wasn't a communist, so I did nothing. When they came to take the social democrats, I wasn't a social democrat, so I did nothing. When they came to take the Jews, I wasn't a Jew, so I did nothing or remained quiet, as we were talking about. When they came to take me, there was no one left. Something of that. It's not a very good rendition, but it's somewhat accurate, I think. So that's all I have to say.
Any last comments?
Can I say just one last thing?
Of course.
Just the theme of so many of the comments here is how do you keep this story alive? What do we do about it? And it's a great turnout that we have here today. But beginning in September, this exhibit will be also at the federal courthouse in downtown Providence. And it's a terrific building in its own right, but it'll be really nice to have this exhibit there. And I would just like to put a pitch out there to those of you who are in the bench and in the bar and in the community who may took the trouble to come out here to Bristol to maybe say something to your colleagues who are downtown to take a minute to come by the courthouse and look at the exhibit. Because I think the answer part to the question is to keep the dialogue going. And that's what the exhibit is all about. And one way to keep that dialogue going is to push people to take a minute and to observe. And so if you would do that, those who are motivated enough to be here, push those a little less motivated to come to the courthouse and take a look at the exhibit.
So thank you all again so much for coming and for participating. This was a terrific event, and I do hope that you spread the word about the exhibit. And please join me one more time in thanking our speakers. Weisberg has some reprints of an article that he wrote that's related to the subject. There are four. There will be available outside. So, rush. Run, don't walk.